and water in oil in water type of so water in
ida feedback and link osa edlo karakla
aa
link ochina kuda nan lepu
naendu
ee sir phone ante cheya mes bandu maatladu kepu maatladukon tarvata le lead feedback osade 3 3 narki appudu
naendu phone
aa ma friend
my request to maintain silence
janka ఎలా థింకే మనన్ని కూడా
పనక 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 నా
వాడ అప్పుడు వంటి గడ అప్పుడు
తెలియదు నాకు తెలియదు
మరి చెప్పలే ఏమంటే చెప్పలే
అంటే ఒకటి గంట కదే పొనుకోలేదు
ఎవర్ అమ్మ మ్యూట్ చేసుకోండి ఎవరాళ్ళు Somebody is talking continuously okay so the emulsions are of for two types that is multiple emulsions are of two types they are oil in water in oil type of emulsions and another one is water in oil in water type of emulsions so water in
good day sir
welcome
hello
लेकिन
So right. So the second type of emulsions are multiple emulsions. So multiple emulsions are of two types. They are also known as emulsions within the emulsions. So here the first type of multiple emulsion is O by W by O type of emulsion. So O by W by O type of emulsion. So in O by W by O type of emulsion. So the oil in water type of emulsion is again dispersed in the oil. So to formulate this type of emulsion. And the second type of multiple emulsion is water in oil in water type of emulsion. So here these are simple emulsions which are W by O type. Again, this emulsion is dispersed in the aqueous phase in order to prepare the water in oil in water type of emulsion. So this is about two types of the emulsions representation. That is O by W by O type of emulsion and W by O by W type of emulsion. W by O by W type of emulsion. And third type of emulsions are micro emulsions. So generally these emulsions will be appearing as clear and they will be representing like transparent solution and the globule size of this particular micro emulsions will be ranging from 0.01 micron. So since the globule size is very less, this emulsion will be appearing as transparent to the naked eye and they also refracts the light. So due to this, cloudy appearance will not be there for micro emulsions. And these emulsions will be appearing like solutions only. And apart from this, we'll be having fine emulsions will be there. So fine emulsions are one. So fine emulsions are one. So which consists of will be having the milky appearance and the globule size in this fine emulsions will be ranging from 0.25 microns to 25 microns. So 0.5 microns to 25 microns. So this classification generally can be done. So based upon the globule size. So if the globule size is more, they are called as macro emulsions. If the globule size is less, they are called as fine and micro emulsions. Apart from we'll be having the multiple emulsions, they are emulsions within emulsions. Emulsion within emulsions. So they are the types or classification of the emulsions. Next, we'll move on to the how to identify the type of emulsion. So as we have discussed that there are two types of emulsions, that is O by W type and W by O type of emulsion. Suppose if emulsion is with you, so you have a question like how to identify that whether it is a W by O type of emulsion or O by W type of emulsion means. So we can identify by performing the identification test. So the identification tests that are available for performing the identifying the type of emulsion is dilution test, dye solubility test, fluorescence test, cobalt chloride filter paper test, and conductivity test. So by performing this particular test, we can identify whether the emulsion is O by W type of emulsion or W by O type of emulsion. So O by W type of emulsion or W by O type of emulsion, right? So the first test is dilution test. So to perform this particular test, what we have to do? So how to take the emulsion in the beaker? Emulsion in the beaker. So how to dilute the emulsion with water, and you have to dilute the emulsion with oil. So the given emulsion has to be divided into two, and you have to take in two beakers. In one beaker you add water, and in another beaker you add oil. So if the emulsion dilutes with water, so it is considered to be O by W type of emulsion. So if the emulsion dilutes with oil, so it is considered to be W by O type of emulsion. So what is the reason here? So the simple principle or logic involved is, so any emulsion will be diluting with the external phase. So since in O by W type of emulsion, water is the external phase, it dilutes with addition of water. In W by O type of emulsion, oil is the external phase, it dilutes with addition of oil. So you can see the diagram. So if the given emulsion is O by W type of emulsion, upon addition with water, it dilutes without any phase change. Upon diluting with the oil, there will be the separation of two phases because the emulsion cannot dilute. Why it cannot dilute means the external phase is water, it dilutes only with water only. It dilutes with only water only. And next type of emulsion is water in oil type of emulsion. So if the given emulsion is W by O type of emulsion, so if you're adding oil, there will be no phase change and dilution will be taking place. When you're adding water, it will be separating. There will be the phase will be changing. There will be phase change will be there. So what is the reason here means, so since oil is the continuous phase, this W by O type of emulsion dilutes with oil only, whereas it cannot dilute with water. Whereas it cannot dilute with the water. So this is the simple test that will be helpful for identification of the emulsion type. Identification of the emulsion type. And apart from the dilution test, we can also identify the emulsion by we'll be having the dye solubility test. So by dye solubility test. So here what we have to do is, in order to identify the emulsion by means of dye solubility test, so we have to take water soluble dye. We have to take water soluble dye and add the water soluble dye to the emulsion. After adding the water soluble dye to the emulsion, you have to examine the emulsion under microscope. So example for water soluble dye is, you can take amaranthrate. When you are adding amaranthrate, it gives red color to the emulsion. So since we are adding water soluble dye, so if the continuous phase is red, that is more red phase is observed, so it is considered to be O by W type of emulsion. If dispersed phase is red, that is discontinuous phase or internal phase is red, so it is considered to be W by O type of emulsion. So this is the representation of how we can see the O by W type of emulsion in the microscope and how we can see the W by O type of emulsion in the microscope. So since we are adding water soluble dye, the dye solubilizes in water and gives continuous red color in O by W type of emulsion. And if you're adding amaranthrate to W by O type of emulsion, so since water will be present as a globules, so the globules will be in red color. So from this, we can identify that whether the emulsion is O by W type of emulsion or W by O type of emulsion. O by W type of emulsion or W by O type of emulsion. Right. So this is the second test that will be helpful for identification of type of emulsion. Apart from, so the emulsion can also be identified by means of fluorescence test. Emulsion can also be identified by means of fluorescence test. So this test is based upon the principle that oil exhibits fluorescence. Oil exhibits fluorescence. So therefore, to detect the fluorescence, what we can do is, so we have to observe the fluorescence of the emulsion by placing or by exposing the emulsion to ultraviolet rays. By exposing the emulsion to UV rays, that is ultraviolet rays. So if the fluorescence is observed in a continuous pattern, so it can be identified as W by O type of emulsion. If fluorescence is seen in a dotted pattern or in the spot pattern, so generally it is considered to be O by W type of emulsion. So what is the principle involved in this particular thing means? So since in O by W type of emulsion, oil is a internal phase. So since oil exhibits fluorescence when UV rays are exposed to the emulsion, so the fluorescence can be seen in spot pattern or it can be seen in dotted pattern. While, so in case of W by O type of emulsion, so since oil is a continuous phase, so when you are exposing UV rays, it shows will be having the continuous fluorescence. By this way, we can identify the type of emulsion from fluorescence test. And the emulsion type can also be identified by means of filter paper test. So it is called as cobalt chloride filter paper test. So here you have to take the filter paper, dip the filter paper in cobalt chloride solution and dry that particular filter paper so that it forms a cobalt chloride filter paper. So after drying, what you have to do is you have to dip the cobalt chloride filter paper in the emulsion. So generally, after dipping into the cobalt chloride solution and drying, the filter paper will be changing to blue color. When the given emulsion is O by W type of emulsion, the blue color of the cobalt chloride filter paper turns into pink color. If color change does not occur, so it is considered to be W by O type of emulsion. If blue color of the cobalt chloride filter paper changes to pink, so generally it is identified as O by W type of emulsion. So this is the fifth test that will be helpful for identification of type of emulsion, and the name of the test is cobalt chloride filter paper test. And last test is electrical conductivity test, or in simple it is also known as conductivity test. So in general, what we have to do is to identify the type of emulsion, so we have to take the emulsion in the beaker. And we have to dip anode and cathode, that is electrodes, in the beaker, and the two are connected to bulb. And if it is O by W type of emulsion, it conducts electricity. So if it is a W by O type of emulsion, it does not conduct electricity. The conductance of electricity can be checked by means of attaching the bulb. So if bulb glows, it is considered to be oil in water type of emulsion. If bulb does not glow, it is considered to be water in oil type of emulsion. So what is the principle involved in identification by means of electrical conductivity test? So the well-known principle is, so water is a good conductor for electricity. So since in O by W type of emulsion, so water is a continuous phase, it is capable of conducting the electricity. While in water in oil type of emulsion, so since water is not the continuous phase, it does not conduct electricity. So from this, we can identify the type of emulsion. So next one is theory of emulsification. As we have discussed that in mixing two liquids, so the two liquids will be immiscible with one another. So here, when you are mixing oil and water, so they too will be immiscible. So what is the reason for immiscibility means? So there exists a interfacial tension between oil and water. So this interfacial tension that exists between the oil and water, so will be responsible for making the two liquids immiscible. But in the formulation of the emulsion, we have to produce a fine dispersion of oil and water. So in order to produce a fine dispersion of oil and water, so we required large interfacial contact. So in order to have a large interfacial contact, so we have to do the work. So that work will be equivalent to gamma into delta A. So that is gamma O by W into delta A, where delta A is change in area and gamma O by W is interfacial tension between oil and water phase. So a high interfacial energy leads to reduction of interfacial area. That means due to this particular work done, the delta G will be becoming negative. So the free energy change will be trying to bring back to delta G is equal to zero. So in this cases, what will be happening means this increase in the interfacial energy leads to decrease in the interfacial area. So due to decrease in the interfacial area, so the globules attain spherical shape and it leads to attracting of one globule to another globule, and therefore the coalescence will be taking place. So therefore these two systems are considered to be thermodynamically unstable system. So to make this particular two systems miserable, so what we can do is we can add the third substance known as stabilizing agent, that is emulsifying agent. So that is emulsifying agent. So here with the addition of emulsifying agent, the coalescence in the emulsion can be prevented. The coalescence in the emulsion can be prevented. So how the coalescence in the emulsion can be prevented means by means of three mechanisms of action. So if you are adding surface active agents, or also known as surfactants, these surfactants, they form a monomolecular film at the solid liquid interface and also reduces the interfacial tension between the two liquids, and therefore it will be helpful for preventing the droplet coalescence, and it will be helpful for the formation of stable emulsion. And apart from this, we can add hydrophilic colloids. When hydrophilic colloids are added as emulsifying agents, they form a film which is multimolecular in structure around the dispersed droplets, and since they are hydrophilic in nature, it favors only the formation of O by W type of emulsions. And last one is finely divided solids. So when finely divided solids are used as emulsifying agent, they resist the coalescence by means of adsorbing at the interface between the two immiscible liquids and forms a film around the dispersed globules and helps in the formation of a stable emulsion. So therefore, to make this particular oil and water a stable system, we can use these three types of substances as emulsifying agent, and therefore coalescence can be prevented and it will be helpful for the formation of a stable emulsion. So now let us see one by one. So that is monomolecular adsorption theory. So according to this particular theory, a stable emulsion is formed by the addition of surface active agents or surfactants as emulsifying agent. So how the surfactants acts as emulsifying agent means, so the surface active agents, it will be responsible for reducing the interfacial tension between the two faces. And also it forms a film which is monomolecular in nature at the solid liquid interface. So by reducing the interfacial tension and forming the monomolecular film at the interface, so the presence of surface charges will be there. That is, particles will be developing some charge, and this charge will be responsible for repulsion between the approaching globules, and therefore coalescence will be prevented, and it helps in the formation of a stable emulsion. And whatever the monomolecular film that is formed by means of surface active agent should be flexible. So why it should be flexible means, so if it is disturbed or if it is broken, so it should be capable of reform very urgently. Why? Because means if this film is not there, again the system will be tending to separation of two phases. So therefore, whatever the film that is formed by means of the surface active agent, so this particular film should be flexible. So this flexibility will be helpful for reforming the film upon breaking or disturb. So in order to achieve the good monomolecular film at the interface and form a stable emulsion, so rather than using the single emulsifying agent, you can use a combination of emulsifying agent. So you can use a combination of emulsifying agent. That is, two emulsifying agents can be used to form the stable emulsion. To form the stable emulsion. So let us see how this particular monomolecular film will be formed. And when the combination of emulsion is suitable. So the first one is, if you are formulating a emulsion by the use of, will be having the sodium acetyl sulfate and cholesterol as a combination of emulsifying agent. So these two emulsifying agent, they form a complex film at the oil water interface. So due to this, when you are using this combination of emulsifying agent, it forms a excellent emulsion. So here you can see this is the oil phase and this is a water phase, where sodium acetyl sulfate is represented with circle with will be having the dashed line, and cholesterol is represented by means of the circle with dark color, that is black color. So if you are mixing this particular two emulsifying agent and if you are formulating the O by W type of emulsion at the solid liquid interface, so they will be orienting in order to form a complex film. So where one molecule of cholesterol and next to cholesterol sodium acetyl sulfate and next to sodium acetyl sulfate cholesterol, like this alternatively it will be arranged at the interface, and therefore the film formed at the interface will be complex, and due to this it results in the excellent emulsion. So suppose the same oil and water mixture, so if it is formulated with sodium acetyl sulfate and oleyl alcohol, so what we are doing is we are replacing the cholesterol with oleyl alcohol. So when you are replacing the cholesterol with oleyl alcohol, it does not form a closed film and it results in the poor emulsion. So why? Because means the molecules which are added as the surface active agents which are added as a emulsifying agent does not form a complex film at the solid liquid interface, and therefore it results in the formation of poor emulsion. And if you are using the combination of acetyl alcohol and sodium oleum, so it forms a closed film, but complexation at the interface is not observed. So this is negligible. So due to this, it results in the poor emulsion. So therefore, whatever the emulsifying agent combination you are going to select, it should form a complex film at the interface so that it will be leading to the formation of stable emulsion. So that it will be leading to the formation of stable and excellent emulsion. So this is about the monomolecular adsorption theory. So this theory also states that the type of emulsion depends upon the HLB value of the emulsifying agent. So what is HLB value means? It is the hydrophilic lipophilic balance of a emulsifying agent. So this HLB value of the emulsifying agent determines whether it produces the O by W type of emulsion or W by O type of emulsion. So if emulsifying agent possesses high HLB value, that is more HLB value, so as per Bancroft rules, so it should produce the O by W type of emulsion. So if the emulsifying agent possesses low HLB value, it produces W by O type of emulsion. So therefore it concludes that, so emulsifying agent with HLB value 3 to 6, they produces W by O type of emulsion. Emulsifying agent with HLB value 9 to 12, they produces O by W type of emulsion. So therefore the type of emulsion depends upon what is the emulsifying agent you are going to select. So if the emulsifying agent is hydrophilic, it produces O by W type of emulsion. If it is lipophilic, it produces W by O type of emulsion. And apart from this particular one, from HLB value also we can determine which type of emulsion will be formed. So emulsifying agent with low HLB value produces W by O type of emulsion, and with high HLB value produces O by W type of emulsions. O by W type of emulsion. Theory is multimolecular adsorption theory. Multimolecular adsorption and film formation theory. So here to form a multimolecular film at the solid liquid interface, so we have to use hydrophilic colloids as emulsifying agent. So when you're using hydrophilic colloids as emulsifying agent, like surfactant, that does not reduces the interfacial tension between the solid and liquid. So instead, when hydrophilic colloids are added as emulsifying agent, they form a multimolecular film at the interface. Due to the formation of this particular multimolecular film at the interface between oil and water, so it resists the approaching of globules and therefore the coalescence can be minimized. And also it promotes the stability by secondary action, that is nothing but auxiliary action. So when hydrophilic colloids are added, it increases the viscosity of the dispersion medium or external phase. Therefore, through increase in viscosity, the movement of the globules will be decreased and hence the coalescence will be decreases. So the emulsifying agent that forms multilayer films around the droplets are hydrophilic in nature, so that the hydrophilic colloids can produce only O by W type of emulsion. And it is not possible to achieve W by O type of emulsion with hydrophilic colloids. Therefore, hydrophilic colloids through the formation of multimolecular film at the solid-liquid interface, it prevents the coalescence and helps in the formulation of stable emulsion. So, and last one is solid particle adsorption. So, in solid particle adsorption, to prepare an emulsion, we have to use finely divided solids like bentonite, etc. So, this finely divided solids that are added will be acting as emulsifying agents. So, these solids, they will be polar and non-polar. So, polar will be wetted by means of water and it will be responsible for producing the O by W type of emulsion. So, on other hand, non-polar will be there. So, non-polar will be wetted by means of oil and they produce W by O type of emulsion. So, this solid, this finely divided solid, they concentrate at the interface and produces a film around the dispersed droplets. And this film will be responsible for preventing the coalescence of droplets in the emulsion. So, solids which are wetted with water produces O by W type of emulsion. And solids which are wetted with oil, they produces W by O type of emulsion. Right? So, this is the representation of the emulsion. So, in which the monomolecular film, multimolecular film and solid particle film will be formed. So, the monomolecular film will be formed at the interface by the surfactants. A multimolecular film will be formed by means of hydrophilic colloids at the interface. And solid particle adsorption will be taking place and film formation will be taking place by means of finely divided solids as emulsifying agents. So, this is about the three concepts, that is monomolecular adsorption, multimolecular film formation, and solid particle adsorption at the interface that prevents the coalescence and helps in the formation of stable emulsion. And next, we'll move on to the what are the requirements for the formulation of the emulsion. To formulate emulsion, drug, oil phase, aqueous phase, and additives are required. To formulate emulsion, we require drug. So, we require oil phase, we require aqueous phase, and also we are in the requirement of additives. So, let us see the first one, drug. So, the selection of drug to formulate emulsion depends upon will be having the required therapeutic effect that is desired for the development of the formulation. So, if a drug is oil soluble, so it has to be dissolved in the oil and it can be dispersed in the aqueous phase to formulate the emulsion. So, if the drug is water soluble, it can be dissolved in water and we can disperse in the oil to formulate a W by O type of emulsion. So, the oil phase, unless otherwise it is a medicament, so we have to select pure oil phase and followed by the oil phase which is going to select for the formulation of the emulsion should be non-toxic. So, the oil phase, it is internal phase in case of O by W type of emulsion. So, the oil phase is a internal phase. Whereas, it is external phase in case of W by O type of emulsions. So, it is a external phase in case of W by O type of emulsion. So, except in the oil phase is an active ingredient, we can use a variety of lipids that are obtained from natural origin and that are obtained from synthetic origin can be used in order to prepare the emulsion. So the examples of oil paces that can be used are, we can use vegetable oils. The examples for vegetable oils is rapeseed oil, castor oil, etc. can be used. And also we can use mineral oil, that is liquid paraffin can be used. And long chain alcohols and polyoxypropylenes and substituted silicones can be used. So these are the different examples of the oil paces that can be used to formulate the emulsion. Unless otherwise, it is an active ingredient. So the oil is the internal phase in O by W type of emulsion, and it is external phase in W by O type of emulsion. So apart from it is an active ingredient, a wide variety of lipids that are obtained from natural origin and synthetic origin, they can be used as an oil phase to formulate the emulsion. So and the next is, apart from the drug and oil phase, we are on the requirement of aqueous phase. So let us see where, what is this particular aqueous phase. So aqueous phase is a internal phase or dispersive phase or discontinuous phase in W by O type of emulsion, and it is an external phase in O by W type of emulsion. So therefore, what is the aqueous phase we can use in the formulation of the emulsions means we can use purified water USP. So this purified water USP preparation already we have discussed in the suspensions. So the same process like reverse osmosis, double distillation, ion exchange treatment can be used to produce the purified water from raw water. The purified water that is produced can be used in the formulation of the emulsion as internal phase and external phase. Apart from the drug and apart from the oil phase and aqueous phase, in the formulation of the emulsion, we are in the requirement of additives. So the main additive that is required to formulate an emulsion is, we are in the requirement of emulsifying agent. So as we have discussed in the definition itself, it is immiscible, the two liquids will be immiscible. To make a stable system, we have to add the third substance known as emulsifying agent. So therefore, the emulsifying agent is a stabilizing agent in the formation of an emulsion. So the selection of emulsifying agent depends upon type of emulsion desired. So suppose if you are in the requirement of O by W type of emulsifying, O by W type of emulsion, so you have to select hydrophilic emulsifying agent. And if you are in the requirement of W by O type of emulsion, you have to select hydrophobic emulsifying agent. And also it depends upon required shelf life. So during its storage, if the emulsifying agent is not stable, the shelf life of the product will be decreased. So therefore, depending upon the shelf life that is required, we have to select the emulsifying agent. So the following substances can be used as emulsifying agent to prepare the stable emulsion. So that is surfactants, hydrophilic colloids, and finely divided solids can be used. So examples of the surfactants are different classes of the surfactants like anionic, cationic, non-ionic, and amphoteric surfactants can be used. So examples for anionic substances are sulfated monoglycerides, and cationic or benzalkonium chloride, non-ionic or polyoxyethylene fatty acid esters, and amphoteric or lecithin. For oral formulations, mostly non-ionic and amphoteric substances are preferred as surfactants that are used as emulsifying agent in the formulation of the emulsions. And next one is finely divided solids. So the examples for finely divided solids are two, that is polar solids and non-polar solids. So polar solids swell with water and non-polar solids swell with organic solvents. So polar solids examples are heavy metal hydroxides and non-swelling clays and pigments are the examples for polar solids. Where for non-polar solids, the examples are carbon stearate and glyceryl tristearate can be used. And apart from, we can use hydrophilic colloids. So this hydrophilic colloids acts as emulsifying agent by means of multimolecular film formation at the interface. Example for the hydrophilic colloids or clays can be used. So example is bentonite. And we can also use natural gums for the formulation of the emulsions. That is acacia, xanthan gum, tragacanth can be used as emulsifying agent to formulate the emulsion. And apart from this particular hydrophilic colloids, finely divided solids, and surfactants and natural gums, we can also use proteins as emulsifying agents. These proteins can be used as emulsifying agent in the formulation of the emulsions which are meant for oral administrations. So these are the different examples, different classes of the substances that can be used as emulsifying agent in the formulation of the emulsion. And apart from the emulsifying agent, so since most of the emulsifying agents are from natural origin and they consist of hydrophilic colloids or they consist of gums, proteins, etc., and water is present, they are more prone to the microbial attack. So therefore, in order to prevent the microbial attack and in order to achieve the antimicrobial effect, so we have to add preservative in the formulation of the emulsion. So in the formulation of the emulsion, we have to add an ideal preservative. So in the previous session, we have discussed about what are the ideal characteristics that a preservative should possess. So here also, we have to use an ideal preservative, which is non-toxic, non-irritant, which is effective against broad spectrum of microorganisms, and it should be compatible with other ingredients in the formulation. So usually the preservative that consists of that particular characteristics is considered to be ideal preservative. The examples of the preservatives that we can use in the formulation of the emulsions are, we can use benzoic acid and salt of benzoic acid, that is sodium benzoate can be used. And sorbic acid and salt of sorbic acid, that is sodium sorbate can be used. Also, we can use boric acid and its salt and parahydroxybenzoic acid like methyl paraben, propyl paraben, etc. can be used. So the selection of preservative depends upon compatibility with other ingredients and the emulsion is used for which purpose, whether it is topical, parenteral or oral purposes, we have to select this particular preservative. And apart from the preservative, so since the emulsion consists of oil, there are more chances for emulsion formulation to undergo oxidation. So therefore, the another additive that is required to maintain the stability of the formulation is antioxidants. So generally, the presence of antioxidants in the formulation helps to prevent oxidative degradation reaction of the product. So therefore, to reduce oxidation in the formulation, the antioxidants are added. So the concentration of the antioxidants that can be added in the formulation is approximately from 0.001 to 0.1%. And the examples of the antioxidants that we can use in the formulation are, so we can use ascorbic acid, butylated hydroxy anisole, butylated hydroxy toluene, tocopherol, gallic acid, propyl gallate, ascorbyl palmitate, sulfites, etc. can be used. And if you are using propyl gallate, gallic acid, etc., they are much effective when you are using in presence of any acids like citric acid, tartaric acid, and phosphoric acid. So therefore, depending upon the compatibility with the other ingredients, we can add the antioxidant in the formulation to prevent the product against oxidative degradation reaction. So and next one is, we are in the requirement of coloring agents. So generally, coloring agents are added. So in order to improve the elegance of the product and to give identity to the product. So therefore, for identification and to have elegance, these coloring agents are added. So the coloring agents of natural and synthetic origin can be used. And coloring agents which are approved by means of FDNC, that is Food, Drug and Cosmetic Act Authority, has to be used. So depending upon the color requirement to the emulsion, we can add Brilliant Blue, Indigo Carmine Blue, Amaranth Red, Tartarizin Yellow and Sunset Yellow can be used. So depending upon the addition of color, it produces blue, red and yellow color to the product. And last one is flavoring agents. Last additive that is required is flavoring agents. So generally, flavoring agents are imparted in order to impart flavor added to the formulation to impart flavor to the products. By imparting the flavor, the patient compliance and acceptance towards the use of the product can be improved. So what are the various types of flavoring agents we can use this? As discussed in the previous session, depending upon the taste sensation, whether a drug is giving salt taste, bitter taste, sour taste, or sweet taste, we can add different flavoring agents like vanilla flavor, raspberry flavor, chocolate flavors, wintergreen mint, anise, passion fruit, citrus flavors, licorice flavors can be used. So generally, these flavors, the addition of this particular flavors impart flavor and therefore the patient compliance can be improved. So these are the different additives that are required for the formulation of the emulsions. Different additives that are required for the formulation of the emulsion. The next one is formulation or manufacturing of the emulsions. Formulation or manufacturing of the emulsion. So here we can use dispersion method. So that means we have to break the internal phase into fine droplets, and the fine droplets of the internal phase has to be stabilized in the external phase before the internal phase get coils. So therefore, to disperse, we have to use two parameters. That is one physical parameter that has to be selected is agitation. That means we have to mix so that to break the internal phase into droplets and to stabilize internal phase into the external phase to form a emulsion. Or we can use heat, right? So we can use heat. Upon heating, the internal phase will be breaking into fine droplets, and we can stabilize in the external phase before it gets coils. So therefore, these two physical parameters are widely used in order to prepare the emulsions. So among this particular two, the trituration method, that is employing the agitation to prepare the emulsion, is widely used, and bottle method is widely used. The trituration method of preparation of the emulsion involves dry gum method and wet gum method. In dry gum method, so all of the gum has to be taken, and oil is added at a time to the gum, and water for primary emulsion is added, and it is triturated continuously in order to form a primary emulsion. So later the emulsion is diluted with remaining phase, and therefore we can prepare the emulsion by means of dry gum method. In wet gum method, what we'll be doing is the gum is first wetted with water for primary emulsion, and oil is added in the drop wise with continuous trituration until to form a primary emulsion. So the primary emulsion formed in both the cases is indicated by means of some whisky sound. So whenever that particular sound is produced, it indicates that primary emulsion has been formed. So after the primary emulsion is formed, so what we have to do is, so we have to make up the volume of the emulsion to the desired volume with remaining amount of the phase. Depending upon whether it is a O by W or W by O type of emulsion, we have to make it. And next method is we can use bottle method. So this bottle method is used for less viscous emulsions. So in this, the emulsifying agent and oil has to be taken, and it has to be mixed with some portion of the water to form a primary emulsion, and later it is diluted with remaining part of the vehicle to formulate the emulsion. So such a method is called as bottle method. In both the cases, we are shaking the both the phases in order to form the product. That is, we are using the physical parameter known as heat. And in case of externally applied emulsion, that is a topical application, this heating process is used. So where we have to heat aqueous phase separately and oil phase separately to same temperature. And after reaching to same temperature, the aqueous phase has to be added to oil phase with continuous stirring. In this case also, we have to use agitation to form the emulsion. So this trituration method of or agitation method of preparation of the dispersion or emulsion generally utilizes mortar and pestle in the small scale. So already we have discussed in the previous session, like, so the mortar and pestle is available in a cheaper, so that we can prepare the emulsion very easily at a low cost, and hence we can prepare the emulsion at low cost, and we can make available in the market in a economical range. But the disadvantages with this particular mortar and pestle are, so generally we cannot produce the large emulsion, and you need to create more amount of shear, so by means of trituration. More energy has to be spent in order to form an emulsion. So this is the disadvantage with mortar and pestle. So of course, in laboratory purpose, to prepare the small volumes of the emulsions, we can use the mortar and pestle, that is either made up of with glass or made up of with porcelain material. So to prepare still higher volumes, what we can do is we can use mechanical equipments for emulsions. We can use the mechanical equipment for emulsification process. So what are the various types of equipments that we can use for the preparation of the emulsions means? So we can use mechanical stirrers, homogenizers, ultrasonifiers, and colloidal milk can be used. So while using this particular mechanical stirrers for emulsification process to take place, so the important factor is, the important factor in the preparation is degree of shear and turbulence required to produce the dispersion. So when you are producing the shear and degree of turbulence in a more manner than required, so automatically instead of forming the stable emulsion, it results in the unstable emulsion. So therefore, what is the degree of shear required and turbulence required to produce the emulsion has to be considered, and accordingly how to select the mechanical equipment for emulsification process. And the selection of equipment also depends upon viscosity of the system and what is the total volume to be emulsified or to be mixed, and what is the interfacial tension at the oil and water interface. If this interfacial tension is more, generally we are in the requirement of high shear producing and turbulence producing equipment. If this interfacial tension and viscosity is less and total volume mixed to be is less, we are in the requirement of equipment that produces the less degree of shear and less turbulence. Less degree of shear and less turbulence. So among the various equipments we have discussed, the first equipment that can be used is mechanical stirrer. So here to prepare emulsion, so here the oil and water along with the emulsifying agent, so they are stirred by means of various types of impellers. They are mounted on the shaft. So this is the representation of shaft, and this is the representation of impeller that is mounted to the shaft. So here the mixture to be emulsified is directly placed in a beaker, and we have to dip into this particular impeller type of mechanical stirrer, and therefore the emulsion will be formed. So this impeller blade is used for relatively low viscous emulsion. If the viscous emulsions are there, the impeller can be replaced with paddle type of blades and counter rotating blades, and planetary mixers can be used. So we have to use this particular counter rotating or planetary rotating blades whenever the viscosity of this particular emulsion is more. So what are the advantages means? So here it is useful for producing the emulsions with low viscosity on a laboratory scale, that is on small scale, where if you want to produce again in bulk quantities, again this particular impeller mixers are not suitable and paddle blades mixers are not suitable, right? So this is about the first mechanical equipment that is used for the preparation of emulsions. And apart from, we can also use two types of homogenizers. So one is the homogenizer that can be dipped into the system that has to be emulsified. So this is the homogenizer where we'll be dipping into the system to be emulsified. And another one is we can pass the mixture through the inlet and collect through the outlet. So how can we achieve the emulsion through this particular usage of homogenizer? So in the homogenizer, which is dipped into the system to be emulsified, so it consists of a shaft, and to this particular shaft at the end will be having the homogenizers will be there. So here the dispersion of the two liquids is achieved by means of forcing this particular internal phase and external phase at a high pressure and impinging on the homogenizer wall, and therefore it will be responsible for breaking the internal phase into fine droplets, and it will be stabilizing the external phase, and it will be helpful for the formulation of stable emulsion. So whenever the emulsion quantity is less in the large scale, in this case we can use will be having this type of homogenizer. So whenever the emulsion is more, so in this case is what we can do is the dispersion of the two liquids is achieved by, we have to, this is the inlet of this particular homogenizer, and this is will be having the outlet of the homogenizer. So where we have to pass this particular homogenizer through the inlet, and we have to collect through the outlet. So here the dispersion which is forced, it impinges on the homogenizing wall, so which is held on the valve seat by means of spring. So therefore, whenever it is impinging on the homogenizing wall or blade, so it will be responsible for breaking the droplets, this internal phase into fine droplets, and it will be placed into the external phase to formulate the emulsion. To prepare the emulsion by the use of this homogenizer, what we have to do is, so we have to force the mixture through the inlet at high pressure. at high pressure. So what is the pressure? We can use this depending upon the quantity and viscosity of the system to be mixed. So it has to be impinged at a pressure rate of 500 to 5000 psh. So whenever you will be forcing at a high pressure through the inlet, so it will be impinging on the homogenizing wall. Whenever it impinges on the homogenized wall, so it produces turbulence and shear, and this particular turbulence and shear will be responsible for breaking the internal phase into fine droplets and placing the internal phase into the external phase, and formation of emulsion will be taking place. And the formed emulsion, which is impinging on the wall, can be collected through the outlet. So here, this can be also built in more than one stage, where the emulsion from the outlet again passes through the inlet of another homogenizer. So until the desired globule size of the emulsion is obtained. So in both the cases, whether you are using the large scale emulsifier or small scale homogenizer, so generally it leads to increase in temperature of the system. That is, emulsion temperature will be increased. Therefore, immediately after collecting through the homogenizer, you have to cool this particular emulsion. So otherwise, it leads to coalescence or flocculation or breaking of the emulsion. So this is how we can prepare the emulsion by the use of homogenizers. So next one is, apart from the homogenizers, we can also use ultrasonifiers. So this ultrasonifiers generates ultrasonic energy. And this is based upon the Pohmann liquid vessel. So where here in the ultrasonifiers will be having the blades will be there, which will be rotating, in order to produce the ultrasonic energy. So the dispersion to be prepared, it is forced through the inlet orifice at moderate pressure, that is from 150 to 350 pascals per square inch gas, and it is allowed to impinge on the rotating blades. So whenever it is impinging on the rotating blades, it generates the ultrasonic energy. This energy will be responsible for breaking the internal phase into fine droplets, and it will be responsible for placing the internal phase into external phase and helpful for the formation of the emulsion, where the emulsion formed is collected through the outlet. So where the ultrasonifiers are used for lab scale preparation of the fluid emulsions only with moderate viscosity. So why? Because means it is having limited output and the equipment is more expensive. So if you are preparing with more expensive equipment, automatically the cost of the product will be more and it will be not economical for the patient. So therefore, it is used for the preparation of the emulsions which are fluid in nature and which is having moderate viscosity only. So for emulsions which possess more viscosity, this ultrasonifiers are not suitable. And last equipment that can be used is colloidal mill. So this is the representation of colloidal mill, so which is used for the preparation of emulsions also. So here the colloidal mill consists of rotor and stator. So where the stator will be stationary in position and rotor will be rotating during the operation. So where the dispersion to be prepared or the emulsion to be prepared is forced through the inlet or it is charged through the inlet. So whenever it is charged through the inlet, it impinges on the rotating rotor and subjected to high rates of shear and turbulence. Whenever the mixer to be emulsified exposed to high shear and turbulence, so the internal phase will be breaking into the droplets and it will be placing into the external phase to form the emulsion. So when you are subjecting the mixture through the colloidal mill to formulate the emulsion, it increases the temperature of the emulsion. So therefore, it can be cooled immediately after collecting through the outlet. So here also, you can recirculate the emulsion in the colloidal mill again until to achieve the desired globule size. So this is the circulatory tube where we can recirculate until to achieve the desired globule size. So these are the various types of the mechanical equipments that can be used for the preparation of emulsions in the research and development laboratories, in the small scale laboratories, as well as in the large scale preparations. And next one is stability of emulsions. So whatever the emulsion we are going to prepare, so it is considered to be physically stable whenever it is having elegant color, odor and taste, provided you are adding the coloring agent, flavoring agent and sweetening agent. Depending upon the additives that are added, if the color, odor and taste is not changed, so it is considered to be physically stable. Apart from these characteristics, so emulsion is said to be physically stable if it is having absence of coalescence, absence of flocculation, absence of creaming, so absence of breaking and phase inversion. If these instabilities are not there in the emulsions, that is emulsion is free from coalescence, flocculation, creaming, breaking and phase inversion, so generally the emulsion is said to be physically stable emulsion. So a good emulsion will be looking like this, in which the internal phase will be dispersed as a globules in the external phase without any coalescence, creaming, flocculation and separation. So whenever it shows instabilities like coalescence, flocculation, creaming and breaking, so the emulsion will be looking like this four ways. Like this four ways. So therefore, when you are observing the emulsion like this four ways, the emulsion is not considered to be physically stable. So whenever the emulsion looks like this, it is considered to be physically stable suspension. Sorry, physically stable emulsion. So what are the reasons for physical instabilities? And how can you overcome this particular physical instabilities? So the first one is coalescence. In the process of coalescence, generally the emulsified globules will be merged together in order to form the large globules. So therefore, whenever the large globules are observed, so in the emulsion, so it is considered to be, will be having the coalescence. So with this, what will be happening means the number of globules present in the emulsion will be reduced and the globule size will be increased. So whenever during the evaluation of suspension and the globule number of globules are decreased and globule size is increased, it indicates that the emulsion is coarse. So what are the reasons for coalescence to take place in the emulsion? So whenever the stabilizing agent or emulsifying agent that is added to the emulsion is insufficient, it is not capable of forming a appropriate film or reducing the interfacial tension, it will be responsible for merging the one emulsified particle with another emulsifying particle, and therefore coalescence may be seen. And whenever the partitioning of the emulsifying agent is altered, so instead of presenting in the aqueous phase or oil phase, so it is partitioning from one phase to another phase during the storing conditions, it may lead to merging of emulsified particles and therefore coalescence may take place. That is due to altered partitioning of the emulsifying agent. And third reason is, if you are adding any substance that is incompatible with emulsifying agent, so either it is another emulsifying agent or it is a preservative or another substance, so whatever it may be, if you are adding, so it will be responsible for, it will be responsible for coalescence to take place. And of course, you are adding the emulsifying agent, but the emulsifying agent that is added in the emulsion does not have adequate strength. The film that is formed at the interface is not having adequate strength. So automatically, whenever the film is broken, it leads to approaching of the droplets and therefore coalescence may be taking place. So since it is well known that due to insufficient amount or incompatible agent or altered partitioning of the emulsifying agent or poor mechanical strength of the film that is formed at the interface by means of the emulsifying agent, the coalescence takes place. While formulating the emulsion, what we have to do is, so you have to select the correct emulsifying agent in the correct concentration range, and you should not add any substance that is incompatible with the emulsifying agent, and whatever the emulsifying agent you are adding should form a film that is flexible at the solid liquid interface. If these precautions are taken, the merging of droplets can be minimized and therefore the coalescence of the droplets can be prevented, emulsified particles can be prevented. So this is what is coalescence and what are the reasons for coalescence and how to overcome the coalescence. So the emulsion is free from coalescence, it is considered to be physically stable emulsion. And next one is flocculation. The second physical instability that can be observed in case of emulsions is flocculation. So in flocculation, the dispersed phase present in the emulsion approaches one another and forms will be having the colonies and forms the colonies. So in the continuous phase, so such a approaching of the internal phase droplets together and forms the colonies or aggregates in the continuous phase is known as flocculation. Where coalescence is different, emulsified globules match together to form a larger globule, while in case of flocculation, the dispersed phase comes together in order to form a aggregate or colonies of the globules in the continuous phase. So this flocculation may take place before creaming or during the creaming process or after the creaming process. So what are the reasons for flocculation to take place? So the main reasons for flocculation to take place is size distribution. Whenever the dispersed globules are not uniform in size, there are the chances for flocculation to take place. And whenever the globule, that the dispersed phase does not have any charge, it will be responsible for flocculation to take place. And last one is, whenever the viscosity of the external medium is less, automatically it encourages the movement of dispersed phase, and therefore the flocculation will be taking place, right? So this globule size distribution, when they are ununiform and when there is no charge on the surface of the globule and viscosity of the external medium is less, it encourages the dispersed phase to attract each other and flocculation will be taking place in the emulsion. So this is how the flocculated suspension will be looking like and how we can prevent this particular flocculation. So flocculation can be prevented by means of producing the emulsion with the fine globule size. That is, the dispersed phase in the emulsion should be possesses uniform size globules. So if the dispersed phase possesses the globules in the uniform size, the flocculation can be prevented. So by proper size reduction process, by the use of homogenizers or by the use of another mechanical equipment, we can produce a uniform size of dispersed phase or globules, and therefore we can prevent the flocculation. And next one is charge on the globule size. So with the addition of emulsifying agent in the preparation of emulsion, if you are using ionic emulsifying agent, so this added ionic emulsifying agent produces charge on the dispersed phase. Whenever there is a charge on the dispersed phase, it will be responsible for generating the repulsive forces. So whenever the repulsive forces are generating, the approaching of the internal droplets will be minimized, and therefore the flocculation can be minimized and the emulsion may be free from flocculation process. And last one is, we can increase the viscosity of the medium. So that is, external medium viscosity can be increased. So if the external medium viscosity is increased, the dispersed phase becomes relatively immobile. That is, the globules present in the emulsion cannot move, and hence the approaching of the droplets or dispersed phase will be minimized, and therefore the flocculation can be prevented. So this is what is flocculation, what are the reasons, and how we can prevent this particular flocculation in the emulsions. And one more instability, physical instability condition of the emulsion is creaming. So one of the naturally available emulsion in the universe is milk. So in the milk, we may observe this particular creaming process. So it is advantageous in that particular milk, where in case of pharmaceutical suspensions, creaming is undesirable. So what will be happening if creaming takes place in the pharmaceutical emulsions means a more concentrated layer of the internal phase will be formed either at top or bottom of the emulsion. Therefore, when a patient is consuming that particular creamed product, he may not get the uniform dose from the emulsion, so that the creaming is not acceptable from pharmaceutical point of view. So what is creaming? In creaming process, the dispersed phase, and what do you mean by dispersed phase means it is internal phase or the discontinuous phase, in according to the density with the external phase, that is continuous phase. So generally, either it rises to top or sink to the bottom of the emulsion by forming a concentrated emulsion. right? So the dispersal phase in relation in relative to the density with the external phase, either it rises to top or it settles at the bottom. So this phenomenon is called as creaming process. Therefore, due to creaming, either at the top of the emulsion or at the bottom of the emulsion, a concentrated emulsion will be formed and remaining emulsion will be diluted. So here, whenever the dispersal phase rises to up direction, so it is called as upward cream. Whenever the dispersal phase settles at the bottom of the emulsion, so it is called as downward cream. So whenever the dispersal phase density is less when compared to the dispersion medium, it rises to up. It rises to up. That is nothing but top. So whenever the dispersal phase density is greater when compared to the dispersion medium, it settles at the bottom and it results in downward cream. And usually this creaming process is reversible. Usually the creaming process is reversible. That means upon shaking, the cream will be the dispersal phase will be distributed uniformly throughout the external phase. So what are the reasons for creaming to take place? What are the reasons for creaming to take place? So creaming is affected by means of globule size, viscosity of the dispersion medium, and density difference between the two mediums, right? So the first one is globule size. If the dispersal phase globules in the emulsion is not uniform, it encourages the creaming in the emulsion. If viscosity of the dispersion medium is less, due to less viscosity of the dispersion medium, the dispersal phase moves in the emulsion to a greater extent. And due to this, we may observe the cream. And when there are more density difference between the internal phase and external phase, that is dispersal phase and dispersion medium, there are the chances for creaming to take place. Hence, in order to avoid the creaming problem in emulsions, what we can do? So creaming process can be reduced by means of producing the emulsion with uniform globule size. This uniform globule size of the dispersal phase can be achieved by means of using the appropriate mechanical equipment, mainly by means of homogenization process. By the use of homogenizer, we can produce the dispersal phase with uniform globule size. And next one is, so we can prevent the creaming process by increasing the viscosity of dispersion medium or external phase in the emulsion. So this viscosity of the external phase or dispersion medium can be increased by adding the viscosity inducing agents or thickening agents like methyl cellulose, tragacanth, or sodium alginate can be used. When you are adding these substances, the viscosity of the external phase will be increased. Whenever the viscosity of the external phase is increased due to high viscosity, the dispersal phase becomes immobile. That means the movement of this particular dispersal phase will be hindered. That means they cannot move. So due to this, they cannot rise to top or settle at the bottom. By this way, the creaming in the emulsion can be prevented. And next one is reducing the density difference between the two phases. That means if the internal phase and external phase are having too much variation in the densities, so we have to reduce this particular density difference between the dispersal phase and dispersion medium to avoid the cream. So of course, usually the dispersal phase, less dense when compared to the dispersion medium, or it may be more dense when compared to the dispersion medium. In both the cases, so we have to take the necessary precautions in such a way that we have to minimize the density difference between the two phases, and therefore the creaming can be prevented. Right? So our next instability condition is breaking or cracking of the emulsion. tracking of the emulsion. This is nothing but separation of emulsion into its constituent phases is known as breaking or cracking of the emulsion. So in emulsions, usually we may see three types of the substances. One is oil, and second one is water, and third one is emulsifying agent. So whenever these components are kept in a condition, it is considered to be emulsion. Whenever they separate into its phases, that is oil into oil, water into water, and emulsifying agent into emulsifying agent, such a phenomenon is called as cracking of the emulsion, or it is also known as breaking of the emulsion. So what are the reasons for breaking or cracking of the emulsion? So generally, the oil and water are making stable with the help of emulsifying agent. So if you're adding any chemical agent that is incompatible with the emulsifying agent, it leads to separation of emulsion into its constituent phases, and the phenomenon is known as breaking or cracking. Suppose if you are formulating the emulsion with cationic emulsifying agent. So if you're adding anionic substance to this particular emulsion, automatically it results in cracking or breaking of the emulsion. And whenever, due to the poor addition of the antimicrobial preservatives, whenever the added preservative does not concentrate in the aqueous phase and at the interface, there are the chances for bacterial growth to take place. Why? Because means water will be present and gums will be present as emulsifying agent, and hydrophilic colloids will be present as emulsifying agent. There are more chances for bacterial growth to take place. Due to this particular growth of bacteria in the emulsion, the property of emulsifying agent may change. That means it may partition from one phase to another phase, and therefore it will be responsible for breaking or cracking of the emulsion. And apart from this, the temperature change. When the emulsion is exposed to high temperatures, or when the emulsion is exposed to too low temperatures like freezing conditions, the property of emulsifying agent may change at that particular high and low temperatures, and due to this, the emulsion will be breaking or cracking. So these are the various reasons for breaking of the emulsion to take place. So how can you prevent this particular breaking or cracking of the emulsion? So you should not add any chemical agent that is incompatible with emulsifying agent, and always to preserve the emulsions, you have to add the antimicrobial preservative that concentrates both in the aqueous phase and at the interface to prevent the microbial growth or bacterial growth in the preparation. And you should not expose the temperature. You should not expose the emulsion to high and low temperatures. This high and low temperatures leads to disruption of film, so as well as the separation of the constituents into the separation of emulsion into its constituent phases will be taking place, and this leads to breaking or cracking of the emulsion, right? And last instability condition is phase inversion. So let us see what is phase inversion. So the phenomenon of conversion of O by W type of emulsion to W by O type and vice versa, that is W by O to O by W type of emulsion, is known as phase inversion process. So this mainly occurs. What is the reason for phase inversion process to take place? Means it occurs due to the alteration in phase volume ratio of the emulsion. This mainly occurs due to alteration in the phase volume ratio of the emulsion. So what is phase volume ratio means? So it is volume of internal phase in the emulsion to total volume of the emulsion. Suppose if you are formulating the emulsion with oil 20 ml and remaining concentration is water, 20 by 100 gives 0.2, it is the phase volume ratio of that particular emulsion. So generally the phase volume ratio should be greater than 0.2 and it should be up to 0.5. So in order to prepare emulsion, when you are trying to incorporate this particular more volume of the internal phase in the emulsion, it may lead to conversion of one type of emulsion to another type, and this phenomenon is called as phase inversion process. Apart from alterations in the phase volume ratios, so if you are adding any additive that alters the hydrophilic lipophilic balance of the emulsifying agent, so it leads to the phase inversion to take place, right? So usually the emulsifying agent with low HLB values produces W by O type of emulsion, and high HLB values produces O by W type of emulsion. Whenever you will be adding any chemical or any additive, that alters the HLB value of emulsifying agent. So due to the addition of that particular agent, if the HLB value of emulsifying agent which is low is increased, it converts one type of emulsion to another type. And this is another reason for phase inversion to take place. Phase inversion to take place. And next one is excess internal phase. If you are trying to add more amount of the internal phase, automatically it leads to conversion of one type of emulsion to another type of emulsion. And if you are adding any electrolyte to the emulsion stabilizer with ionic surfactants. Suppose if you are adding the anionic substance to emulsion that is stabilized with cationic emulsifying agent, vice versa, it leads to phase inversion process. Phase inversion process. So let us see the example, that is a O by W type of emulsion. If it is formulated with sodium stearate as emulsifying agent, so it is inverted into W by O type of emulsion with the addition of the electrolyte like calcium chloride. The addition of calcium chloride. So with the addition of calcium chloride, what will be happening means, instead of sodium stearate, the emulsifying agent will be converting into calcium stearate. So due to conversion into calcium stearate, so it favors the formation of W by O type of emulsion. So since calcium stearate is the emulsifying agent with low HLB value, the O by W type of emulsion will be converting into W by O type of emulsion. So these are the various instabilities of the emulsion. So whenever the emulsion is free from these particular instabilities like flocculation, coalescence, creaming, breaking, and phase inversion process, so generally such emulsion is said to be physically stable. Such emulsion is considered to be physically stable. Whenever the manufactured emulsion, either by means of any equipment, is free from these particular physical instabilities, so such emulsion is considered to be physically stable emulsion. Physically stable emulsion. So let us see where this particular biphasic liquid dosage forms can be stored. So both suspensions and emulsions, which are biphasic liquid dosage form, they can be filled into the individual containers that are made up of with glass or plastic. So nowadays, for easy handling and transportation, storage and shipping, the glass is replaced by means of the containers which are made up of with plastic due to light in weight and easy to handle and easy to store, right? So if a glass bottle is used, it is made up of with soda lime glass or treated soda lime glass. So, and this emulsion or suspension that is manufactured by means of the various equipment or filled into this particular containers by using various types of filling machines. By using various types of filling machines. So what are that particular filling machines means? That is gravimetric filling machine, volumetric liquid filling machine, and constant level filling machines. So all these particular three filling equipments can be used for filling of both suspensions and emulsions. Both suspensions and emulsions. So let us see the first one, that is gravimetric filling. So the name itself indicate that. So here this filling process involves filling the containers to a given way. So means, so first of all, the empty container has to be placed on the balance, and we have to tear the balance weight to zero, and we have to fill the container to a given way, right? So until it reaches to certain weight, that is 25 grams or 50 grams, etc. So what are the limitations with this particular gravimetric filling processes? So it is used for large size containers and highly viscous products. And the principle that is used to filling process does not lend to the development of high speed automatic equipment. And therefore filling by means of gravimetric means of the liquid preparation, that is biphasic liquid preparations into the containers, is less commonly used in the pharmaceutical industries. Whereas the filling can be done by means of volumetric liquid filling process and constant level filling process. So here the second filling process is volumetric liquid filling process. Volumetric liquid filling process. So this is the representation of volumetric liquid filling process. The principle involved in the volumetric liquid filling process is positive displacement piston action. So here, this is the filling station, which is equipped with piston and cylinder. And they out, and it is connected to the bulk tank, which consists of suspension or emulsion. So due to this particular operation of piston and cylinder in the volumetric liquid filling machine, so it displaces some amount of the liquid from the bulk tank into the volumetric liquid filling machine. So where upon operation, it delivers into the bottle. It delivers into the bottle. So this is how the liquid preparations will be filled into the individual containers by the use of volumetric liquid filling machine. By the use of volumetric liquid filling machine. So here we can fill the liquids very accurately with a high degree of accuracy when the viscosity of this particular liquids is moderate. So whenever the viscosity is high, what will be happening means, so thereby the chances of blocking and therefore uniform filling cannot be achieved. Whenever the two viscous liquids are there, they will be flowing very fastly. And with this also, we cannot achieve the uniform filling. So we can achieve the accuracy in filling process with moderate viscous liquids by the use of volumetric liquid filling machine. And to achieve the uniform filling, the containers also should be of uniform size, right? So whenever the containers are varying in dimensions, with oversized containers, the slack fill can be achieved. With undersized containers, excessive fill can be absorbed. Even though the fill amount is same in both the containers, so in oversized containers, we may feel that less amount is filled. And in undersized container, we may feel that excessive amount is filled. So in order to avoid this particular one, so we have to use uniform size containers to fill by means of volumetric liquid filling process. Liquid filling process. And next one is constant level filling process. Constant level filling process. So this constant level filling process is based upon the Siphon principle. So where the Siphon principle is, it induces a pressure difference between the liquid discharge nozzle and bulk liquid tank. So this pressure difference will be responsible for filling the liquid into the container. And this uses the container as the means for controlling the fill of each unit. So means we can place the filling tube to the desired constant level or height up to which the liquid has to be filled. So up to that, the liquid will be filling and we can remove the container. And here also we have to use the containers with uniform dimensions. So in order to fill the product very accurately. So there are three types of filling process are there. That is vacuum filling, gravity vacuum filling and pressure vacuum filling. So let us see one by one how to fill the liquid preparation by the use of this particular three filling process. So in vacuum filling process, what we can do is, so here the bulk storage tank, which consists of liquid preparation like suspension and emulsion, they have to be connected with the bottle, which has to be filled. So this is the filling head. So, and we have to place a tube in order to collect the excess liquid from the bottle. And we have to make a seal between the filling head and the container. When you are making a seal, the container will be empty and bulk storage tank will consist of liquid. So the vacuum will be developed in the empty container. This vacuum developed in the empty container causes the liquid to flow from the bulk liquid tank into the container. And this will be filling until to the level by which the vacuum tube is adjusted. Suppose if you want to fill up to the neck, the vacuum tube has to be adjusted up to the neck. Suppose if you want to fill half the quantity, the vacuum tube has to be adjusted to half of the quantity of the bottle. So that the level of the vacuum tube has to be adjusted in such a way that, so you have to position up to the desired constant level of filling of the bottle. So whenever the bottle is filling up to the desired level, the excess liquid can be collected through vacuum and it can be recirculated into the bulk tank. So by this way, the liquid can be filled into the bottle from the bulk liquid storage tank. So this process is called as vacuum filling process. And the next one is gravity vacuum filling process. So here the assembly is similar, but the bulk storage tank, which consists of liquid preparation, has to be placed above the filling head. So means the tank should be at top position and this particular bottle should be at downward position. Here, along with the development of vacuum in the empty container, the gravitational forces will be responsible for movement of the liquid oral from the bulk tank to the container. So by this way, we can fill the liquid orals with high viscosity. By this way, we can fill the liquid orals with high viscosity. And third one is pressure vacuum filling process. So in vacuum filling process, what we can do is we can keep both side by side. In gravity vacuum filling process, we have to place this particular bulk storage tank, which consists of liquid preparation like suspension and emulsion, at a high level, so that the gravitational forces along with vacuum will be responsible for filling the product into the container. In pressure vacuum filling process, what we have to do is the representation of the assembly is same. Both will be present side by side. So the vacuum developed in the empty container along with the pressure that is applied from the bulk storage tank will be responsible for movement of the liquid into the container. So therefore, the container will be filled with the suspension or emulsion. So the advantage with this particular pressure vacuum filling process means, so since we are applying the pressure from the bulk storage tank side, so it is useful for filling the highly viscous liquids also. For example, if you want to fill highly viscous emulsions and highly viscous suspension, you can use either gravity or pressure vacuum filling process. In vacuum, only vacuum generation will be responsible for filling. It is used for moderately viscous liquids to be filled into the containers. So these are the various filling techniques that can be used for filling of the liquid preparations like suspensions and emulsions into the individual glass or plastic bottles. So finally, after the filling is over, the container has to be attached with a label. So what are the labeling requirements that are required for the emulsions and suspensions? So usually the label should contain the name of the preparation. That is, what is the preparation name has to be mentioned in the center of the label. And volume of the preparation, that is whether it contains 50 ml or 100 ml, it should be also there on the label. And composition, this is the concentration of the medicament that is present in the suspension or emulsion has to be mentioned. So means each family of the suspension or emulsion contains how much mg of the drug or active ingredient. And in both the emulsions and suspensions, you have to mention shake well before use. So it indicates the patient before dispensing the dose of the drug. So the container has to be shake well before the usage, so that it will be helpful for dispensing uniform dose of the drug. And you have to mention the dose of that particular preparation. So either 1 teaspoonful or tablespoonful to be administered has to be mentioned, or 5 ml or 10 ml to be administered has to be mentioned. So if the drug is a Schedule H drug, so generally you can mention as directed by physician. That means the patient has to consume the product or administer the product depending upon the directions given by means of the physician. And you have to mention the what are the storage conditions. That means to be stored at what temperature and what conditions has to be mentioned. So usually the suspensions and emulsions has to be stored in a well-closed container and in a cool place. And manufacture date and expiry date. So what is the date of manufacturing? And up to 1 year, the expiry date will be there for emulsified products or suspensions. You can mention that particular expiry date. And next one is batch number and license number. So in which batch you are going to prepare the product and what is the license number that you are getting in order to manufacture the product has to be mentioned. And last but not least, you have to mention the address of the manufacturing company and you have to mention the address of marketing company. So these are the various requirements for labeling of both suspensions and emulsions. In case of suspensions, you have to remember one more thing, that is directions for reconstitution. So sometimes in the bottles, we may absorb the powder. So it contains all the ingredients except vehicle. Before usage, it has to be reconstituted with boiled and cool water. So what are the directions for reconstitution and how much days you have to use after reconstitution has to be mentioned on the label for reconstituted suspensions. So this is about the filling and labeling of this particular emulsions and suspensions. So with this, the concepts on two biphasic liquid dosage forms, that is suspensions and emulsions is completed. So in the previous session we have discussed about suspensions, and in this session we have discussed about emulsions. Now the session is open for questions. So if you are having any doubts regarding today's session, you can ask very freely. So one of you has mentioned what is coalescence. As we have already seen that in emulsions two phases will be there. So the dispersed phase will be merging together in order to form a large globule, and such a process is called as coalescence. And one of you have seen that why ultrasonifiers are more costly. So since the ultrasonifiers has to generate ultrasonic energy, so the vibrating blades that are used to generate the ultrasonic energy in the ultrasonifiers will be costly, and therefore the cost of the equipment will be high, and we can produce very low amount of the emulsion with such a costly equipment, and therefore the product cost will be increases. Any more questions? Any one of you, if you are having any doubts, now the session is open for questionnaire. So we have completed the discussion regarding the concepts and equipment that are used for manufacturing of the emulsions today. And in the previous session, we have completed the suspensions. Multiple emulsions mainly are used for the formulation of sustained and controlled release formulations. Sustained and controlled release formulation. Suppose if the administered dosage form has to release the drug for more and prolonged period of time. So in these cases, emulsion can be again dispersed in the oil and that can be administered. So since the drug from the emulsion has to partition from the three phases, it releases very slowly, and therefore prolonged and followed by sustained drug release can be achieved. Right. So what is the difference between wet gum method and dry gum method? So generally we have seen that gums are also used as emulsifying agent. In dry gum method, what you have to do is, so you have to take the gum in the dry water, and you should not add water for primary emulsion. And the gum wet cheyakunda. Wet cheyakunda, all of the water and water for primary emulsion has to be added, and you have to triturate thoroughly until to form a emulsion, and then emulsion has to be triturated, and then emulsion has to be make up to the final volume. But in wet gum method, in this first step of preparation, the gum has to be wetted with water. After wetting, you should not add oil at once. You have to add drop wise, and after addition of each drop, you have to triturate thoroughly until to form a primary emulsion. And in both cases, after the formation of primary emulsion, we can make up to the required volume. So ultrasonifier is used to produce either multiple emulsions or simple emulsions, or fine emulsions or micro emulsions, but they can be used for producing small quantities of the emulsion. Therefore, in large in R&D purposes, so whenever low quantities of the emulsions are required by means of the equipment, we can use this particular ultrasonifiers. So what is phase inversion and dispersion? Dispersion means the dispersing of internal phase into external phase to form a stable system is called as dispersion. Phase inversion is different. Suppose if your aim is to formulate a one type of emulsion, depending upon the experimental conditions, it converts into another type. So such a conversion of O by W to W by O type and W by O to O by W type of emulsion is called as phase inversion process. మీరు ఎప్పుడైనా డిస్పర్సివ్ ఫేస్ ఎక్కువ యాడ్ చేయడానికి ఇంటర్నల్ ఫేస్ ఎక్కువ యాడ్ చేయడానికి ట్రై చేశారనుకోండి, ఇట్ లీడ్స్ టు ఫేస్ ఇన్వర్షన్. లేదు ఇఫ్ యూర్ యాడింగ్ ఎనీ ఇన్కంపాటిబుల్ ఏజెంట్ విత్ ఎమన్స్ఫైయింగ్ ఏజెంట్, ఇట్ ఆల్టర్స్ ది ప్రాపర్టీస్ ఆఫ్ ద ఎమన్స్ఫైయింగ్ ఏజెంట్ అండ్ దేర్ ఫర్ ఇట్ కాజెస్ ది phase inversion problem. Phase inversion problem. So that is the difference between phase inversion and dispersion. So I think since there are no questions, I can close this session. If you are having questions, you can ask. If no questions are there, we can leave the session. Varaprasad. Who is Varaprasad? Okay. So in the absence of questions from the participants and from the audience, so I am closing this particular session, and we have completed the today's session very successfully. And I thank to organizers and participants for giving me this opportunity. So one question has been raised from the participant side. What is fluorescence test? Explain, sir. So usually when oil is exposed to ultraviolet rays, It exhibits fluorescence. And based upon this particular principle, fluorescence test can be used to identify the type of emulsion. Enduku ante emulsion lo oil water rendu untai kabatti, so oil exhibits fluorescence. So in OBW type of emulsion, oil is present as globules in the water. Kabatti you can observe the fluorescence in the dotted pattern or in the spot pattern. Whereas in W/O type of emulsion, the oil is the continuous phase. Ekku untadu kabatti you can observe the continuous fluorescence, by which you can differentiate whether the emulsion is O/W type of emulsion or W/O type of emulsion. Right? So is it clear, Ganesh? Okay. Thank you. So thank you participants. So we'll meet on Monday. Tomorrow session is not there. Again, we'll meet on Monday. And with Monday session, I will be completing this particular biphasic liquid dosage form evaluation also. Thank you very much. Thank you.